Are you creating a form, but you need to restrict what people are allowed to put into the form? Well, this video is for you because I'm going to be breaking down the data validation rules that are available to us inside of Airtable Forms. So if learning more about how you can restrict what people are allowed to put into your form is of interest to you, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth, and this is Gap Consulting. It's our mission here to help you get the full potential out of your no-code tools like Airtable. And in this very video, I'm going to be breaking down forms specifically around data validation, how we can make sure that people are only allowed to give us the type of data we're looking for. But before I get into the heart of things, I first want to invite you to join me for some free training. I've put together an Airtable crash course that teaches all the basic building blocks of Airtable in nice bite-sized lessons, and I will deliver that to you for free if you sign up at gapconsulting.io/airtable-crash-course. All right, without further ado, let's go ahead and hop on into my screen. We're going to be building a form from scratch, and I am starting with a table that really doesn't have much of anything except for a couple of linked relationships here. And I've got three things, and I'm going to go ahead and build a form in Airtable. Now, before I get to this, couple of things I need to say up front. Number one, the rules of Airtable, what's allowed on one account versus a different plan, is constantly changing. Right now I'm on a business plan, but most of what I'm going to demonstrate here is available on the free plan, but that could be subject to change, right? So Airtable does make changes, and unfortunately to their pricing, not everything always makes it on that pricing page. So if you try to do one of the things that I'm demonstrating here, it might be a limitation due to the plan you're on with Airtable. I'm going to try to make it ubiquitous and try to include stuff that's involved or available on the free plan as well. Now, the other thing I want to highlight is that forms can be built in two places. One of them is forms here, which coincidentally enough, should be pretty straightforward. This is where we build those public facing forms. But if you want to build a form that is specific to an interface, you can do that as well by going to interfaces first and then bringing in a form component into your interfaces. You have the option of creating an interface page that is a form, or you can add form pop-ups on a different page so that people can just create new records there. For our purposes here, we're going to be looking at the more advanced form, so we're going to be heading over there. Okay, now we'll flip on over to forms. You could grab a template or you can just start and create a new form, which I'm going to do. Now, every form has one purpose and one purpose only in Airtable. I've said this a lot. I feel like a broken record sometimes, but it bears repeating. A form creates a record in a table. And those are both singular words in both examples. Creates one record in one table every time it's submitted. That's the only thing an Airtable form does. If you're looking for more advanced functionality, if you want someone to create a record in multiple places, different tables, or different databases, then an Airtable form might not be the right answer for you. You might go with a different, more robust form software and then parse that data out via some more advanced automation. But if you're looking for a straightforward, submit this information, create one record in one place, then an Airtable form is perfect because you don't have to go outside of the Airtable environment. You already have the form, you already have the data, everything else is working. So it's a great, great form solution. Now, just bear in mind that it only serves that very specific purpose. So we will be forced to choose here where we are going to be creating our records via our form submission. So for us, I'll just choose table one and I'll just call my form new form. I can always change this later, but it's easier if you get it right the first time you're setting it up. Now, here we are in the form itself. And by default, it's showing us the first field, which is the name field. If we want to bring more fields into our form, we can click this button here, which allows us to add additional fields from our initial data. So if you recall, our original table had the name field, and then it had two links, a link to table two and a link to table three. So that's what we see here. And we can also create fields in our form. Now there's another place that we can do this. We can do it over here on the fields. So we can click on fields here on the right-hand side of the page, and we can easily toggle on multiple fields if we want to bring them in. Now for us, I don't necessarily need to see these things, so I'm going to go ahead and close them down. I can additionally build new fields here from my form. So if a field does not yet exist in my data set, as in our example, I can create it. So let's create a number field, and I'll just call this number, and we'll go ahead and set this up. And I'll add another field, I'll add a date field, and drop that in. And let's also bring in some long text. And so these are all just different field types, bear in mind. And then lastly, I'll bring in a single select field as well. And let's call this status, and it has these samples. All right, so I've added these fields now to our database. So if I flip back in on the data side of things, I'll open this in a new tab. Flipping back over here, you'll see that those fields have now been created. And they're immediately mapped. So if they are entered in on our form, they're going to show up here. But the point of our video here is to add some data validation to these different field types. So let's start with the single line text. If I select this field on the right hand side of the screen, you see the field properties. So I can change the name, the way it shows up on the form. I can, of course, edit the data source. I can change the appearance. I can alter the visibility, but of course, this is not available for the first element on a form, but I can make the other fields conditionally visible based on what's happened previously in the form submission. I can add default values, so I could add a sample here, and by default, you'll see that that's what's going to be filled out when people are accessing the form. We can allow users to edit the field or not. This is something that becomes available, especially after we've included a default value. I can make it required, but then the last one, here we go, character limit. This is a little bit of data validation. Now, bear in mind, this is going to be specific for the single line text field. That's the type of field that this particular one is. And the data validation will be different. The available options will be different based on your field types. So of course that kind of makes sense, but we're gonna go through many different field types to look at different examples. But this particular field, this is a single line text field. It's a short text blurb, right? It does not have multiple lines of text, but it does allow us to enter in, kind of free form here. And we can set up some character limits. So for example, we can have a minimum and a maximum of 10 and 100. And so by putting this in, if I were to pre-fill this form and try to submit it without meeting the minimum number of characters, then this would be an invalid submission and I would not be able to proceed. Similarly, if I had more than 100 characters of text here, that would be too long and I would not be able to proceed with a submission. So this gives us a little bit of data validation around text. Now let's look at a number. So this is a number field, right? Same thing, a very similar settings that we had as to the last one, but here I have a range limit. So I can set up a range between certain things. So I might say, maybe this has to be a negative number. It has to be negative between 0 and -20. So I've established the minimum and the maximum as a range. And so now similarly, if people were to try to put in different information here, it's not going to allow it. Now, dates are a weird one because we get a range limit on dates and we don't quite have the same flexibility with dates that you might hope for. Because what I would love with dates, and maybe it's coming soon from Airtable, is some flexible dates around the current date. So let's say, for example, I want to limit someone's submission to be, it has to be 14 days from whatever today's date is. Well, I don't really get that functionality here. If I choose the current date and save this, I don't get the ability to put a date in the future as an example. But I could say that I have a specific date and I could put something out 14 days in the future. And this now would, as of today, as of recording, today is what, the 5th of August. And so if I were to put this forth, This one is relative, meaning this date is going to change every day. So by putting this rule in place, this is, as of today, August 5th, and the maximum is August 19th. So people have a short window with which to choose dates. But as the days progress and the current day rolls on, soon, within 2 weeks' time, it will be greater than the maximum date. And then people will not be able to find a valid date at all. So what I wish we could do is get some, you know, more dynamic data in here. Maybe the ability to say, I want to add, you know, 14 days to the current date as an example. But as of right now, we don't have that much flexibility in our date validations. So again, for now, we can choose the current date. We can choose a specific date, either in the future or in the past, or we can set no limit. And again, we're setting up a minimum and a maximum so that the answers have to be within that range. And whether we're hard coding that date as with a specific date, or we're using the relative current date, those are the most advanced options that we have in Airtable forms for date validation. Now let's take a look at the long text field here. We can apply similarly a character limit here, and it's the same rules as the single line text. And we just have a minimum and a maximum for characters. So again, I'll go with 10 and 100 here. And then here on the status, we don't actually, for drop downs or single select fields, we don't actually get the same data validation option in the same way, but we can limit the selection to specific drop downs. So if you go into your options here, you can choose exactly what the user is allowed to pick from. So for us, we have three different options, the to do, in progress, and done, but we're only going to allow our users to pick from in progress and done, and we can make this a required field. So in this way, we're getting data validation, although it doesn't quite show up at the bottom of the form in the same way. Let's go ahead and give this form a publish now, and we can go in and actually sample it out. So we choose who can access the form, we can copy the link and open it in a new window, which I'm doing here. And let's go ahead and test out our data validation. So if I use my first name, it's less than 10 characters, only 6. And if I were to try to submit, you're going to get this warning here that your input must be at least 10 characters long. So I might go back in and make my full name, and now I would be able to submit, although I haven't yet met the requirements for this one. Let me pick a number here. I'll pick, gosh, I don't even remember. Oh, we said between a range of negative 20 and 0. So let me intentionally pick something outside of that range. I'm noticing that I made a mistake on the form and did not allow negative numbers. So this is proof for you that we're going to have issues, and we need to go back and edit the form if we have, you know, some validation rules that are not compliant with the way that we structured our data. So if we go back to numbers, you'll see what I mean. I have not enabled negative numbers apparently on this field, and yet I established a range limit. So if we go back to the actual data layer itself and we check on the number field, you'll see that we do not have negative numbers allowed, which is inherited in the form. So we have to make sure to toggle this on and save those changes in order for people to be able to put in numbers like negative 50. So I'll have to go ahead and refresh my page here in order to absorb those new rules. And now I can put in negative 50. And again, you're going to see that my value is not in compliance. And so I might make a change. And now it is. With our dates, we have from the current day, which is August 5th, to the 19th that we hard coded. So if I pick the 4th, it has to be a date on or after today. I could pick something after the 19th. And I'm going to get the flag that it's not meeting the larger of the data validation rules. So I'll pick something in the middle. Notes here, not too short. And now we're long enough. And then lastly, on the status, it's a required field and we only see the two options, not the three. Now, once we submit, just like with any Airtable form, that information goes immediately into our table and is stored right here. And so now we're able to collect that information. And perhaps most importantly, we get to ensure that we get the values that we expected within the ranges that we established for our form. So I hope that using data validation helps you build better, smarter forms in Airtable. And if you got some value from this video, we'd love it if you could give us a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel. Of course, if you have more advanced questions that we didn't address, swing by our website. We have a ton of resources there for your disposal. And of course, most importantly, keep on building.